Well, I think the tax incidence, the burden of taxes should be least on workers and earnings, more on wealth, capital gains and dividends, more on corporations who are seriously undertaxed. The IRS issued a report recently that between 1996 and 2000, 60% of U.S. corporations paid no federal income tax. 70% of foreign corporations operating here paid no federal income tax. The revenue base is now nourished by only 7.5% from corporate taxes, when under Eisenhower it was over 30%. What we need is to get the tax system back to more what was in the prosperous 60s, which would go a long way to reduce the deficit, go a long way to provide for a public works program to repair a crumbling infrastructure in our country, crumbling schools and clinics and public transit systems and drinking water systems, and create good paying jobs that cannot be exported to China.
Do you worry on the subject of export, though? Because I'm actually imagining both of you in office. I'm not trying to picture this. And if that's what you do, are you worried that in this global economy, all these corporations are going to run off to Liechtenstein and the Cayman Islands, just flee the country because they'll give news conferences that say America is unfriendly to business under Ralph Nader?
Well, the problem in our country is the corporations are the government. They've got their top executives in Department of Defense, Treasury. That's what they do. They have huge numbers of lobbyists in Washington. They are 80% of the financing of federal elections. They are the government. You just read the Wall Street Journal, Business Week, and so on. They have wonderful documentation of this. Business Week had a cover called Too Much Corporate Power. And they answered it, yes, 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 in 7 pages, and they editorialized that corporations should get out of politics. So they are strategically planning, as you imply in your question, they're strategically planning our economy, our politics, our election, even our genetic inheritance they want to convert into Monsanto-type patents, our environment, our education, our food. They want to privatize our water. So the key here is a constitutional amendment, if I may add, that decides that the sovereignty of the people has to be supreme over the power of corporations, who must be our servants, not our masters. Otherwise, they can abandon the country, continue to get tax breaks, continue to have the Marines defend them overseas, continue to have subsidies, handouts, and giveaways from the taxpayer to corporate welfare in Washington, and our standard of living will continue to decline.
But what I asked was, they're really going to leave if you pass that constitutional amendment. They're just going to get out of town.
Oh, no. They can leave. Of course they can leave. They can go to Walmart and go to China. But they're not going to be able to control this economy. And there will be other entrepreneurs and small businesses coming up. But we're not going to allow giant corporations to use dictatorships overseas as their labor enforcement arms, driving down our standards of living, not only by shipping to China or telling companies in this country, if you don't supply us Walmart, with the China price, shut down and go to China. But WTO and NAFTA are systems of transnational forms of autocratic governance that subordinate our own courts and our own regulatory agencies and health, environment, labor, and consumer standards. I mean, this is unbelievable. The attack on the sovereignty is unprecedented in this country. So if these giant corporations have no allegiance to our country, other to abandon it, well, good riddance. There are plenty of investors and small companies, entrepreneurs, that can replace them.
Mr. Peroutka, are you nodding to be polite, or you agree with
it? No, actually, well, I agree with a lot of the outcomes that Mr. Nader, we come from foundationally different places, but I certainly agree that NAFTA, GATT, WTO are things that are violations of America's sovereignty.
You also think the UN is, too.
Of course, yeah. The UN. Well, see, you have foreign bureaucrats making decisions for the American people, and they're not accountable to the American people or to the Congress or to the Senate.
Except the U.S. has a veto in the U.N. It has no veto in WTO and NAFTA.
Yeah, but that's really a distinction without a real difference, I would claim. I do agree with Mr. Nader that these things are violations of America's sovereignty. I guess where I would, again, respectfully disagree is that, and I can see that there are these greedy situations and corrupt situations in government, but I would say that the problem is because we have centralized this power and this authority. There's a lot there to corrupt if we followed the formula of our founding fathers and that those things weren't centralized or consolidated. There would be less to corrupt. That's another way that we could solve this problem, and I believe it's a constitutional one.
Briefly, I want to ask you both this issue. We are where we are in Iraq. Both of you would like us to get out of Iraq as soon as possible, ASAP. But Mr. Peroutka, what do we owe the Iraqis, given all that's happened? if anything?
Well, we certainly owe them an apology for violating their autonomy and invading their country and occupying their territory. The threshold question in Iraq is, are we there legally and lawfully? In the Constitution, the very first sentence is, all legislative authority here and granted is vested in a Congress of the United States, and the power to declare war is a congressional power. It's vested in Congress. It can't be usurped by the president or ceded to him by a willing Congress. We are not there lawfully. We have not declared war. And so we are hated and we are despised. We are doing something that is outside of our authority. Now, I'm not defending Saddam Hussein, but this.
But how do we undo it? Let's say we accept that premise so far.
We move out as swiftly and as safely as possible, caring for our troops. Look, the President of the United States, Mr. Bush, in his recent acceptance speech, talked about making the world safer. He is not the president of the world. There's, again, a false presupposition there. He's not the president of the Middle East. His constituency is not the world. His constituency is the American people. John Adams said that we don't go in search of monsters to destroy. We are friends of liberty everywhere, but we are guardians of our own liberty. So where we start in principle is defending the interests of America, and this war for empire in Iraq, which will draft your daughters before it's all over, is something that is, as I say, a war in search of a rationale. There was no yellow cake, there was no connection to Al-Qaeda, and there were no weapons of mass destruction.
Mr. Nader, do we owe something to the Iraqis, just given everything that's happened?
Of course.
Or we just got to get out of there ASAP?
Of course. First of all, we helped entrench Saddam Hussein with the British in 1979 because he was our anti-communist, brutal dictatorship. In the 1990s, we supported these terrible sanctions, economic sanctions, didn't bother Saddam, that were very cruel on children. A physician's task force went to Iraq many times and documented about 500,000 children dying because of these sanctions. For example, banning the export of chlorine for clean drinking water led to all kinds of dysentery and diarrhea that were fatal to these little kids. So we do owe them a responsibility. And here's what we should do. If we continue the present course, where George W. Bush and John Kerry are now both hawks, a vote for Kerry is now a vote for war. He made it quite clear in his presidential debate that he wanted to be more aggressive in pursuing this war than George W. Bush. What we're going to get is more civil war, a puppet government with their own soldiers, backed by the U.S. military, backed by the oil companies taking over their oil industry. We're going to get more bloodshed. And the only way this course of action will end is with lots of U.S. casualties, lots of Iraqi casualties, and another dictatorship in Iraq doing our bidding. Now,
it would leave a festering wound.
No, here's how. We need to give mainstream Iraqis a sense of a light at the end of the tunnel. The way you get mainstream Iraqis to knock the bottom out of the resistance is to get rid of the occupation. It's the occupation that's breeding the resistance. It's the takeover of their only resource by U.S. Texas oil companies that's breeding the resistance. So if we say to the Iraqis, we are going to withdraw in 6 months, a responsible, orderly withdrawal of our military and corporate forces. In the meantime, have internationally supervised elections so they get their country back without a puppet government. And in the meantime, bringing in international peacekeepers from nearby Islamic countries and some neutral countries to make sure that the transition to order is established, we will have made the best out of a terrible situation. Otherwise, we are simply pursuing so-called international terrorism by creating more of it, more alienation, more violence, more hatred radiating throughout the Islamic world. And that is not being debated by Bush or Kerry. They have taken it off the table. They're arguing over tactics, over how we got into war, and I agree. This was an unconstitutional war. Article 1, Section 8 gives the war declaration power only to Congress. Madison Jefferson was very clear about that. It is not a technicality. So right from the beginning, it was unconstitutional war. It violated international law, and we were plunged in it by Bush on a platform of fabrications and deceptions and lies, which the media has now thoroughly documented. We have to give the Iraqis their country back. That's the way to knock the bottom out of the resistance.